So, good morning. Title is Domain Analysis, and in that we are going to study about the domain class model. So, under this, already you have started with the unit. So whenever you are given a problem statement, you directly don't go in for the implementation part. So you're going to spend a lot of time in the analysis and design phase. So here, the first part in object-oriented modeling and design is construction of a domain class model. So what happens over here is, you're going to perform the analysis of the requirement. So first thing that you do is analysis of requirement. Okay. So once you analyze the requirement, then you are going to take a further step. So what you are going to do basically in the domain class model, since it is an object oriented paradigm, so here you will be identifying the classes. So your classes and objects are the main entities in an object oriented system. So here what we are going to do is, we are going to define the objects and the classes. So first thing is identification of classes. Okay. Once you have identified the classes, so classes, how you are going to identify them? By making an observation in the real world system. So the real world entities will become your class name. So how we have done it? By reading the problem statement and looking out at the nouns. So nouns and pronouns will become the class name. Okay. So after you identify the classes, the next thing would be to identify the relationship between classes. So the technical term used in object-oriented modeling and design is, you're going to identify the relationship by the term association. So if there are any relationship between classes, so that is going to be captured with the help of association. Okay? These are the main entities in a domain class model. First you identify the classes, and then you identify the relationship with our classes. Apart from this, again you are going to identify the properties or the attributes of a class. Okay? So the next thing would be identification of attributes or the properties of an object. Okay? So first is the classes. You identify the class name. Then you find out the relationship that exists between classes. It is termed as association. Then you will identify the properties which will describe an object or a class, and they are called as attributes or properties. So once you are done with this, then this is done in the initial phase. Okay? So where you have the crude model. Okay? It's not the finalized version of the model, because you full requirements. You are just analyzing them. Okay? So what happens? Once this iteration is over, then you will get to know what are the classes and the relationships. So once you get to know the classes and the relationship, then you will have to perform organizing of them. So how will you organize them? Organize them with the help of the concept called as inheritance. So inheritance is what? So you know that there is a super subclass hierarchy, where the super class will have the most common or the generic features. And if you want to inherit any features from the previous class, that is the super class, okay, you can put the subclasses at the bottom. So the subclasses will be inheriting all the features from the super class. So this is the overall gist of domain analysis. That is, in constructing a domain class model, first thing what you will do is, you will identify the classes or the objects that will form the real world problem. So they are nothing but the things or entity that you observe from the real world problem. Then the next thing is identifying the relationship between. So the term used is association over here. Then you will have to describe the properties of the objects or the classes, that is done by using attributes or properties. Then after you get these things, you are going to organize them into some hierarchy, that is called as inheritance. So we know already the advantage of inheritance is what? You do not have to build from the scratch. You can always make use of whatever is existing. Okay. Now, there are other things that you have to keep in mind, that the domain class model, in constructing that, you are going to identify all of them with the knowledge of the previous things. So what are the knowledge bases which are contributing in the construction of domain class models? The first one is you will get the knowledge from the problem statement itself. Okay. So problem statement is the first contributing factor for construction of domain class model. Then next is the artifacts from the related system. Artifacts from related system. So this also is a contributing factor which will help us in developing the domain class model. Okay. So the next thing is the expertise knowledge. So knowledge from experts. Okay. Their knowledge. So they will be using their expertise and identifying some of the entities which we have discussed previously. Okay. The next thing is from general knowledge also. So identifying classes, associations and attributes. So that could happen with the help of the general knowledge also. So all these are the contributing factors using which we can develop a domain class model. Okay. Now, next topic that we are going to discuss is about attributes. How to pick out the right attributes. Okay. So the topic is keeping the right attributes. Okay. So while selecting the attribute, you should keep in mind the following thing. That is, you can eliminate the unnecessary attributes for a class by using these criteria. That is, first thing you will have to check out whether that object, whatever you are identifying the attributes, they are proper attributes for that object or not. Clarify that. Second thing is, identify whether that whatever you identify as an attribute is a qualifier. If it's a qualifier, it should be classified as a qualifier, not as an attribute. Then the next thing is, if the attribute is a name, then you cannot take it as some other entity. It should be classified as an attribute because the names of a people can be the same. So it should be classified as an attribute. Then identifier, internal implementation of an object-oriented system should not be taken for representing attributes or anything else. So it is completely internal to the system and it should not be represented as an attribute. Don't make a mistake of representing it as an attribute. And suppose if there is an association between two different classes and because of that association you are having some attributes which are jointly shared by both of the classes, they should not be classified as an attribute of a base class. It should be an attribute of a association. Okay. Then internal value, again, it is considered with respect to the internal implementation. You are not supposed to represent internal implementation part in the design thing. So you should not represent it as an attribute. Fine detail. So do not oversee the problem and spend too much of time or complex or build more complexity. So don't go into too much of detail. Then discordant attributes. If the attributes that you have identified, they are quite a little bit irrelevant, then it means that they are supposed to be split. They are supposed to be split as attributes of different classes. Then if there are any Boolean attributes, they should be represented in the form of enumeration. Okay. So all these following points should be considered while representing the attributes so that you can rightly form the attributes for a class. So here for our unit we have taken an example of banking system, ATM bank system. So we have initially constructed the diagram. Now we'll have to further go in for the further iterations. That is, initially we have identified the major classes and their associations. Next step would be to add attributes for the ATM bank. The main thing attributes. Already we in the previous sessions we have seen how to identify the classes and how to relate the classes, that is using association. So here we are going to add the main entity. Here is being added is attributes. So here first we have identified the class as consortium. So this is the name of the class. Okay, so it is having a qualifier here. I am representing the qualifier over here. So that is the barcode. So here it is a composition. It is composing of bank. Then you are having the card code here. This is a qualifier associated with respect to bank. So here I am adding an attribute. So this is the name of the bank is an attribute over here. So the qualifier I am attaching over here is station code. So this is the qualifier. So here you are having your account code. This is a qualifier. Then you are having your employee code. This is also a qualifier. So you are having your central computer. This is also a class, central computer. Okay. So its qualifier is station code. So you are having ATM class. So here the attribute identified is cash on hand. So it is associated with remote transaction. So remote transaction is a class name. So here the attributes are kind, what kind of transaction, the date and time of transaction, the amount. Okay, so the association name here is entered on, and the multiplicity values are 1:many. Star indicates many. So the bank is associated with account. So account is the name of the class. So attributes are balance, credit limit and type. These are the attributes. So the it is associated again with customer. So name and address of the customer are the attributes. So 1:many is the association. Here the multiplicity value is 1 account code is associated with 0 or 1 account. So bank is associated with a bank computer. So the qualifier attached over here is station code. So here the association is 1:1. So here you have one more class, cashier station. So that is associated with cashier transaction. So again here you have kind, date and time, then the amount. So these are the attributes. So customer. So again you have an association between remote transaction and cash card. So here password is the attribute. So authorized by is the association name. So these are the associations. So I have drawn the crude diagram over here. It's not the final one. So you can refer the text. So the main thing is account, customer, cashier transaction and cash. So in the first iteration you have identified these classes and then you have identified the association, that is the relationship between classes. So how you represent that in the domain class model? Using solid lines between the classes. Also on the qualifiers, so how you specify the rectangular box, you can specify the name of the association by the multiplicity. So here in the diagram, main thing is added over here. For account class, we have identified balance, credit limit, type. For customer class, we have identified name and basically the properties which will describe a class or an cashier, the name. For cashier transaction, it is the kind, date and time, and amount are the attributes. For cash card, it is the password. So in the domain class model, we started with identifying classes and then we have identified the association. The next step would be to add the attributes. So now we have done that for the case study with respect to ATM. So next thing is iterating a class model. So before that, we'll just have a discussion on how refining is being done with respect to inheritance. Okay, the next topic is refining with inheritance. To remember two main approaches, that is bottom up and top down. Okay, so once you have done identifying class name, the association, and have added the attributes for the class, next thing is to organize them in some hierarchy. Why we go in for inheritance or organizing it in some hierarchy? Because we want to inherit most of the basic features. We do not want to start designing or coding from the scratch. We are going to take the existing, features. We are going to copy the existing features. So there are two approaches with respect to inheritance, bottom up or top down. In bottom up, what happens is you are going to generalize the features. Okay, the more generic features are going to be shifted at the top. Okay, So in top down, what happens? If there is a common, if there are any special features, you are going to add them at the bottom. So more specialization happens at the bottom level. Okay? Between bottom and top down. So here we are going to apply it to the ATM case study. So the refined ATM case study. So here I will be drawing the diagram. So the topic is, it is an ATM class model with attributes and inheritance. So already we have seen in the previous diagram that we have identified the attributes for the classes. Now the next thing what we are going to see is how the diagram can be organized by applying the concept of inheritance. So here the class at the top here is entry station. So here you are going to represent generalization. This symbol is used for representing generalization, that is inheritance. So the top class is entry station. So it has been specialized into two more classes, that is ATM and cashier station. So entry station is the generic class. It has been specialized into ATM and cashier station. Okay, so then you can represent their subclasses. So here you have the central computer and here you are having the bank computer. Okay, so here entry station is associated with transaction. So you write down. With this symbol, this symbol represents generalization or inheritance. So I'm not going to draw the complete diagram. Already you have done it in the previous classes. So main emphasis of this a diagram here is how to identify or organize them into some hierarchy. The concept is called as inheritance. So here you can see you have the base class being represented at the top. So you are having entry station. It has been generalized into two more classes, ATM and cashier station. Again it is being specialized more over here at the bottom. Here you are having transaction as a base class. It's being again specialized into two more classes. Cashier transaction and remote transaction, and these are the other subclasses below it. Okay, so here we have studied about up till now identifying classes, identifying their associations, then adding attributes in the class, and finally organizing them into some hierarchy with the concept of inheritance. Now next, we are going to study one more concept here, that is shifting the level of abstraction. Before that, we'll just have a discussion on it. Okay. So, the next concept is iterating a class model. So, the topic says that you are not going to consider construction of a domain class model at once. It is going to have n number of refinements, because we know that we are not able to analyze at the very first instance. It will take some judgment, and finally model. Okay. So what are the some of the signs which will indicate you that you are missing some of the classes? So if you identify any of these points after you have constructed the domain class model, then you can think that some classes may be missing. First point says that asymmetry in association and generalization. If there is some asymmetry that is occurring between generalization and association, it indicates that some class is missing. Then the second point says that disparate attributes and operations on a class. If there are any disparate attributes or there are any operations which are existing in a class, indicates that some of the classes are missing. If you have any difficulty in generalizing cleanly, then that also indicates that some important classes are missing. Next point says that duplicate associations with the same name and purpose. So if you have represented duplicate associations that are indicating again the same purpose, then it indicates some classes are overdone. A role that substantially shapes the semantics of the class. So if you overcome across any of these points, then it indicates that some of the classes may be redundant or some of the classes are missing. So all these points should be considered while designing a domain class model. So finally, we have arrived at the finalized ATM class model with the further revision. The title is ATM class model after further revision. So after applying n number of iterations, finally you conclude with the following thing. What you have identified finally? So the main classes are transaction, entry station, cashier transaction, remote transaction, update. So under entry station, you are having ATM and cashier station. You have identified consortium, bank, cashier, cash card, card authorization, account, customer, update. All these are the, okay. So here the association between transaction and entry station is entered on, okay. So entry station is associated with transaction by the name entered on. So the multiplicity value is 1:1. One entry station will have multiple transactions being entered on it. So here you are showing aggregation. So transaction is being composed of many updates. Okay. So you are identifying the attributes of updates as the amount and the kind of update. So here it is shown as an aggregation. It is comprising of updates. And here transaction is being specialized into two more classes, that is cashier transaction and remote transaction. So then again further associations are shown below. So consortium and bank are being associated. There is a qualifier which is connecting both of them. That is the bank code is the qualifier for consortium. So here you can see composition. Consortium is composed of bank. So this symbol, hollow diamond shaped symbol, shows composition. So this is the finalized model of ATM bank system. So the next concept is shifting the level of abstraction. So what is abstraction? So abstraction basically is we are not going to of details of the system at present. Why? Because we want to avoid the complexity. So here we are taking an example of the different hierarchy of the working level in an organization. So the three different categories of people are an individual contributor. So he is a type of worker who has to report to his next upper level hierarchy. That is, his manager could be supervisor. And a supervisor who is working in an organization will have to report to the top level authority, that is manager. So this is representing the hierarchy of different workers in an organization. So initially we have considered this as a model. So here you can see it is a refined model where what we are doing is, instead of writing the different roles of an individual, we have identified it as a class by the name person. Okay, and we have identified some attributes for this class. The attribute name are employee type and reporting level. So what we have done is we have cut short the role of different people and we have put a common theme and we have identified it as a class by the name person with the following attributes. And here it's a self association. So here on this side it's a boss and he's a worker. So here you can have zero or one boss because we finally want to terminate. So after the manager, it may be the some other person after whom it has to terminate somewhere. So that's why that zero is represented. Okay. So this type of model is more abstract. But why abstraction is considered while designing is, so you can just read a comment over here. Abstraction makes a model more complex. Even though it makes it more complex, why we go in for abstraction in a model? Because it helps us in reducing the number of classes. So here if you see, you could have 1, 2, 3 classes, but all of them have been combined and we have kept a common class. But here the type or the nature of each worker is being classified as an attribute. So here it helps in reducing the number of classes. So this approach can be followed while you are designing your class. So next we are going to study about grouping classes into packages. We are going to group classes into packages. So already you know that a class consists of common properties and operations. Going to be grouped again into a higher called as what all we have discussed. Can be by the name bank. Thank you. So in the beginning of the classes we have seen class with state. So you will have to identify those classes for whom you want to represent the different states. The next thing is find what are those states. Okay, so you have to find out what are the states, give appropriate names for those states. Okay, find events. So a particular object will be in one state unless and until it is disturbed by some external event. So what are those events which will help in the making a transition to the next state? Find out those events. Then build it. Actually you construct the state diagram, and then evaluate whatever you have constructed whether it is correct or not. So here we have taken an example of again ATM bank system. We have considered the account class. So you know that it is going to be in different states during its operation. So initially the account, so this so start state. So here once a customer or a person opens an account, it will be in the normal state. Now if a person closes the account, okay, the event that causes to make a transition from normal state to closed state is closed account. So this is account is the event. So from making a transition from normal to overdrawn, so what is the event which is causing a transition from normal to overdrawn? Withdrawing excess funds. So if your state called as overdrawn, again if you deposit back those funds, you will move to the normal state. So here from making a transition from normal to suspended, what are the events? So if you suspect any fraud, so it will move, make a transition from normal to suspended. Again if you release the hold, it will move back to the normal state. Then for making a transition from normal to suspended, so it could be an admin action. The action is taken by the administrator. Or if you are repeatedly entering incorrect PIN number, again you will be moving into this particular state. So basically class model will give you the static structure of the problem domain. Then state model will help you to capture the life history of objects, how they evolve with respect to or change with respect to time. So iterating the analysis means initially tackle with the problem statement, you are going to perform a lot diploma is taken up. In domain analysis, we have started with the domain class model. Basic understanding of the static structure or the nature of the problem statement. Once we have understood the class diagram, which identifying the classes, identifying the